Hey there, I'm Ethan Iverson, and this is First Look.
Hi, I'm Don Was, president of Blue Note Records, and our guest on First Look today is the brilliant pianist and composer, Ethan Iverson. He first came to prominence as a founding member of the great trio, The Bad Plus. And after leaving that group about 5 years ago, he launched a number of new endeavors, including collaborations with Billy Hart and Albert Heath and the Mark Morris Dance Troupe. His Blue Note debut album, Every Note Is True, finds him once again in a trio setting, this time with two legends, Jack DeJohnette on the drums and Larry Grenadier on the bass. And in accordance with his previous work, and actually in accordance with the legacy of Blue Note Records, the album finds Ethan once again taking his mastery of the musical traditions that preceded him and turning them upside down to create something brand new and stunning. Ethan, welcome to First Look and welcome to Blue Note Records, man.
Don, I've been a longtime fan of both Don Was and, of course, Blue Note Records. So, you know, it's a real pleasure to be on the label and be talking to you.
Thank you, man. And congratulations on this beautiful new album. One of the things I love about it is that it seems to pick up a thread of some of your earlier recordings, but with a new maturity and a greater depth of experience, I think. Was there an underlying conceptual vision for how this album was going to end up when you first started?
Yes, I would say that the album was quite planned in my mind anyway, which was, since leaving the Bad Plus, I've written a lot of music. Hardly a week goes by without a tune coming to mind. And I've been involved in a lot of larger scale projects with composition as well. And suddenly, for the first time, Don, I started to sing my own tunes, walking around Brooklyn or wherever. And I guess I feel like that's a little bit my arrival as a composer, is that I'm actually writing melodies that I myself find catchy. So when the opportunity came up to play with Jack DeJohnette and Larry, I thought, well, let me just pick the best tunes I've been coming up with. And press release of this album, you know, sort of leans into the fact that it's a return to something of the Bad Plus style. I would say there's no Bad Plus without Reed and Dave. But what is true is that there's a simplicity of harmony. I've always really liked clear harmony. I've liked clear harmony since I was a teenager. And jazz harmony, it tends to be quite thick, and that's beautiful too. But I've always wanted to make a little bit of room for some triadic harmony, for some simple harmony. And that, I think, ties into the title of the record, Every Note Is True. There's a clarity to the harmonic language that I believe in, that I've always believed in. It was really in the forefront of the Bad Plus, and now it's back with this trio project.
The first release from the record is a combination of the first two tracks, the very poignant kind of prelude called The More Changes, which contains an eternal verity, and a song called The Eternal Verities. And I meant to tell you this when I saw you last month. When you first sent me The More It Changes, I remember playing it. I was cooking breakfast, and I just burst out in tears, man. I was crying like a baby. It's the most succinct and eloquent and bittersweet summary of a couple of things, both the eternal nature of music and the musicians who create it. But as I read it on a larger scale, the eternal nature of organic chemistry and carbon life forms. That's my interpretation. It's elegant poetic science, I think, man. And tell us a little bit about that song.
Well, Don, that's really sweet of you to say. I have to say that I myself have cried listening to the track. And my wife, Sarah Deming, who wrote the lyrics, she cries. And the people who've sung it, they cry. It does have some meaning. There's a lot of talk of how bad things are. But you sort of got to believe in the future. And also, for so many of us, things are actually better than they ever have been. So, whatever we're doing here, you got to have hope and believe that, you know, it comes around.
Let's play this song.
The more it changes, the more it stays the same. We pass the ball to other ages.
That's Ethan Iverson from his new album, Every Note Is True. Let's talk about the second half of the first single, The Eternal Verities. I understand it comes from something your mother-in-law said to you?
Yeah, she likes to go on her back porch and contemplate the eternal verities. And I thought, well, that sounds like a song. It's literally like a song cue from a musical or something, you know. And so I wrote it the next day. It's hard to talk about your own aesthetic a little bit. I'm also a bit of a critic, and I have written a lot of words about jazz on the internet. So I always feel a little shy in these situations where I have to sort of explain what I'm trying to do. But I do really like European classical music. And if I have something that's distinctive in my style, it is a full-on acceptance of that. I'm not worried of sounding like European classical music for a moment here and there. It's almost like a fanfare or a procession or something like this, the Eternal Verities, and it's a slow build. That's sort of like the Bad Plus. The Bad Plus would do these slow builds. And if you're playing great jazz with jazz masters, that's not an automatic aesthetic. You know, the slow build from a whisper to a scream. But of course, I didn't need to explain it to Larry and Jack. They got it in a second. We didn't even talk about it. And it was one take.
Wow.
You know, played it. I listened to half of the playback, and I thought, no, let's not go any further with that. That's, you know, we'll accept that, and we're lucky to have it.
It's a beautiful piece, man. Let's listen to it. That's Ethan Iverson, The Eternal Verities, from his new album, Every Note Is True. One of my favorite tracks on the album is For Ellen Raskin. I just find it to be another deeply touching composition, man. Tell us about it.
Well, I did write certain pieces with Larry and Jack in mind, especially Jack, who's, I think, you know, in his late 70s, and I don't want to have to explain anything to him. He doesn't know me. He's going to meet me for 2 days. My job is to be super nice, and especially if I'm presenting him with original music, I don't want him to have to feel like he has to go to school or study the aesthetic of Ethan Iverson or anything like that. I want to give him music that he'll want to play right away and that we don't have to talk about it. I believe Jack really loves John Coltrane and McCoy Tyner. Like, these are two lodestars for him. And he got to play with both of them. He sat in the Coltrane Quartet. He played with McCoy a fair amount. And his own piano playing, which is excellent, is informed by that tradition. I'm thinking about Coltrane because I should play some kind of Coltrane kind of things for Jack DeJohnette, if you're following me. And I don't always play a jazz waltz because they can be, they don't always fit what I'm feeling about. But there's a really great Coltrane track, Spiritual, recorded live at the Village Vanguard, this heavy swinging jazz waltz. It's epic and it's beautiful. And I know I've heard Jack play sort of that feel over the years. First track on Michael Brecker's first solo album has that sort of feel, like a jazz waltz. And I thought, well, let me actually write a jazz waltz at the spiritual tempo for Jack DeJohnette.
It is very cool, man. Let's play it. Thank you. Hi, that's Ethan Iverson from his new Blue Note album, Every Note Is True. Ethan, man, it's a colossal record, man. I really love it, and it's an honor to have you on the label. Welcome to Blue Note Records. Here's to many more records together. Thanks for watching, everybody. See you next time. If you enjoyed First Look and would like to see more, please hit the subscribe button and also click the bell icon. That way, you'll be notified when we post our next video.